for the reading of God's word. This is what the Lord says, who makes a way in the sea and a path through raging water, who brings out the chariot and horse, the army and the mighty one together. They lie down, they do not rise again. They are extinguished, put out like a wick. Do not remember the past events. Pay no attention to things of old. Look, I'm about to do something new. Even now it is coming. Do you not see it? Indeed, I will make a way in the wilderness, rivers in the desert. The people I formed for myself will declare my praise. I am the one. I sweep away your transgressions for my own sake and remember your sins no more.
Worship you. sing this. This is our prayer. Trust.
We make miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are.
We make miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Amen. God, that is who you are. And we're here today to praise you and worship you because of who you are. What a privilege and joy to start a new week, God, together in this place with our church family and our friends and our neighbors to lift high the name of Jesus. God, we're going to thank you now and praise you now for all that you're going to do, for all that you've already done, and for all that you're doing in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Well, hey, take a seat just a moment. I'm so thankful that you're here today to worship the Lord with us on this beautiful Sunday morning. Listen, if you're new to Grace Life and you'd like to know more, a couple ways you can do that. There's a tearaway tab on that worship guide that somebody handed you. You're welcome to fill any or part or all of that out. There's a place you can drop that today. These clear boxes sort of behind me to my left and to my right. There's also a QR code on that if you want to scan that, and you can do all of that electronically. And I'd love to hear from you and serve you and help you any way that I possibly can. You can also sign up for our next membership class, which is coming up not too long from now. By the way, already this year, nearly 60 people have come to our membership class just in the year 2022 here. Now, the next one is not going to happen in the month of April. It's going to happen in the month of May. That's a little unusual, and here's why. We're expecting April to be super, super busy around here, all right? And so we thought maybe it would be best to just pause membership class until May, all right? So just heads up on that. If you're looking to get into the membership class, it'll be, I think, third Sunday of May, maybe? 10th? May 10th? It's not on Mother's Day, whenever that is. So just know that, all right? I don't want to get anybody in trouble here today. But listen, I am thankful that you're here. Hey, would you stand with me? I appreciate Leslie opening us up with Scripture today. Let's stand. I want to read this verse as well. I want you just to listen to this. We come to church, we're singing, but we're not the only ones singing here today. The Bible says in Zephaniah chapter 3, the Lord your God is among you, a warrior who saves. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will be quiet in his love. He will delight in you with singing. Isn't that great? So God, as we lift our voices to sing to you today, open our hearts and ears that we could hear you sing over us, your people today. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave. A child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Chosen me, love has called my name. I've been born again into your family, your blood flows through. Child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear.
God, we applaud you. God, throughout history, over and over and over again, you have made a way for your people. God, you split the sea to make a way for your people, and you have caused the city to just be in crumbles. God, you have over and over again made a way for us to know your freedom. But all those things compel in comparison to Jesus, when you came to this earth and you took on the very nature of a servant, being obedient even to death, to make a way for us to know the power of your resurrection. Amen. Jesus, you are the way and the truth and the life, and we put all of our hope in you. How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end.
See. Come on, boys and girls. Y'all make that hard to come behind. You know that, right? Like, let's just keep going. One day we won't stop. What's up, boys and girls? How's everybody doing? Good? Is anybody out of school this week for spring break? Just a few? Some of you just got finished with spring break, right? Some of you got another week to go. And then you know what's right around the corner? Huh? Easter's right around the corner? Yep, that's big time. Summer, right? Can you wait? I can't wait. Vacation Bible School and Camp Shadow Lake and all kinds of crazy good stuff, right? Pastor to go with you? No? He said no. I get that a lot. Let's see what we got today, boys and girls. Check that out. Anybody know what this is? A towel. Yeah, it is. It's a towel. How about that? Wonder why we have a towel in here today. Oh, look at this. Check this out. Somebody took our towels a while back, and they put this beautiful embroidery on it, GLBC baptism. They put that on there so people wouldn't clean the tables and the floors with our good towels. Your grandma or your mama may have a good towel at her house she don't let anybody use, all right? So that's kind of what this is around here at Grace Life. And so today, the reason I pulled this out is because one of our young girls here at Grace Life is actually going to be baptized today out in the student center in the old sanctuary right after the 11 o'clock service today. Riley Price, her dad's back there in the sound booth today. Adam, you're going to baptize Riley today, right? Yeah, yeah. Pastor Joel didn't even bring swim trunks today. I'm just going to celebrate with the Prices and just watch Adam baptize his little girl Riley. So that's exciting, right? Yeah. Maybe the last baptism that happens on this campus. Maybe not. I don't know. But it's the only one I know of that's scheduled right now. So pretty historic. So if you want to come check that out today after the 11 o'clock service, come on, hang out with us. There's another reason that I brought this towel out today, too. Because today, we're going to be looking in John chapter 13, and Jesus does something with a towel. And so I want you guys to pay real close attention today as we dive into God's word and see what Jesus does with a towel today. How about that? Cool? All right, let me pray for you. God, thank you so much for our boys and our girls, and thank you for their families. Thank you for Riley, God, following you in baptism today, and for Mom and Dad and grandparents, they're faithful to point her to Jesus. And today we get to celebrate Jesus, that you love her and you gave your life for her and you've made her your own now for all of eternity. Thank you for that. God, we pray for anybody that may be here today, young or old, that may never have given their life to you, Jesus, that today would be the day that they would do that. And God, as we open up your word today, Holy Spirit, guide us and teach us and change us. And well, thank you for it. In Jesus' good name we pray. And all the boys and girls said, amen. All right, I will see you later, boys and girls. Well, I want to go from the highlight of my week with the boys and girls to open it up with a not-so-cheery question. If you knew you only had one day left to live, what would you do with that? What would come to your mind? How would you live your last day? What would you do? Where would you go? Who would be the people that you would want to surround yourself with? What comes to my mind is, what would I want to eat? Right? Important questions like that. Skydiving, Rocky Mountain climbing, going 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu is not really on my bucket list. It might be on yours, but it's not on mine. But I could come up with a bucket list if I knew I only had 24 hours left. I could make a list of the places I'd want to go, the people I'd want to be with, the things that I'd want to do, and most certainly the things that I'd want to eat. I bet you could come up with a bucket list, too, if you knew that this was it for you. I bet you've thought about that maybe from time to time. Even right now, you can probably, if you're not already, thinking about where you'd want to go, who you'd want to be with, what you would want to do, what you would want to eat. If you got a Bible today, and I hope you do, let's turn to John's Gospel, John chapter 13. John 13 is the beginning of the last day of Jesus' life, before he'll go to the cross to pay for my sin and for your sin. And while I doubt that any of us here in this room this morning know when our last 24 hours is, Jesus knew. He knew. He's got less than 24 hours to live. And what I want us to see today in John chapter 13 is this. What was on his mind? What was in his heart? What was on his agenda in the final moments of his last day? Over the last 4 to 5 weeks here at Grace Life, we've been really turning our hearts toward this. We want to know Jesus better, right? And I don't know that there's any better way to know Jesus than to take the time that we have between now and Easter and really focus in on some of the important moments of his last day. And so that's the journey that we're going to go on beginning today. Today we want to go with Jesus to the upper room. Then we want to go with Jesus into the garden. Then we want to go with Jesus into the courtyard outside Caiaphas's home. Then we want to go with Jesus to the palace where he stands before Pilate. And then for our Good Friday service, we'll go with Jesus to the cross. And I hope that you've already marked off your calendar for our annual Good Friday service, which is always a blessing and a joy and very, very special time together. So please, if you haven't marked that off, you're not going to want to miss that. I promise you that. So today, we're in the upper room, and I want us to see on this last day, what was on Jesus's mind? What was in his heart? What was on his agenda? First, let's look at what was on Jesus's mind. As we look at John chapter 13, I think there's four things that we see that were on the mind of Jesus. The first is this, his destiny. His destiny, as he's there in that upper room with his disciples, his destiny is on his mind. Look at verse 1 of chapter 13, before the Passover celebration. Jesus knew. He knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. Jesus knew that his destiny would lead him to this Passover. He knew all along that it would lead him to this room. He had known that for all of eternity. He had known that. The Passover celebration was and still is, an annual time for the Jewish people to reflect back on when they were slaves in Egypt and what God did to deliver his people out of slavery. That God had commanded them to take a spotless lamb and to take the life of that lamb and to put the blood of that lamb on the wooden door frames vertically and horizontally over their homes. So that night in Egypt, when the death angel came over and God poured out his judgment against Egypt, when that angel would see that the blood of that lamb had been applied to that home, then that wrath of God would pass over that family and they would be saved. The Bible says that Jesus is our lamb, that he was slain before the foundation of the world. Before there was a world, Jesus and his destiny had already been set, already been determined, and the destiny of Jesus on this last day of his life is unchangeable, unalterable. The rise and fall of countless kings and kingdoms throughout human history could do nothing to change Jesus' date with destiny. He is, think about this, the eternal, timeless Jesus. And yet on this Thursday evening, he is watching the sun go down. And he knows, the eternal, timeless one knows, his hour has come. But I want you to see that his destination is not only unchangeable in regards to this day and to what's going to happen there at the cross. He knows that, but he knows something else too. Look at verse 1 again. Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. Look, he knows what's going to happen over the next several hours, the next 16 hours or so. He knows how he's going to suffer. He knows the agony that he's going to endure. He knows how awful it's going to be. He knows everything that's going to happen. And he knows that by far the worst part's not the nails. The worst part's not the flogging that he'll take on his back. The worst part is that he is going to suffer under the wrath of his Father for your sin and for my sin. God is going to be pouring out his judgment against sin on his Son, Jesus. Jesus knows that the most excruciating thing about everything that he's about to experience isn't the physical, it's the spiritual. It's the fact and the reality that his Father, for the first time and only time in all of eternity, is going to turn his back on his Son, and will not be able to look upon him and our sin, your sin, my sin, that will be on Jesus in that moment. Jesus knew all of that, but he also knew, look at the text, that he would return to his Father. His destiny's on his mind. He knows that the redemptive plan of God is not going to be stopped. Yes, Jesus, the man in human flesh, he's going to struggle under the weight of all of this, but his mind is made up. He will carry the cross. He will endure. He will complete the work. He will, because he knows that his Father will raise him up on the third day and seat him at his right hand. Jesus knows that his destiny is what's on his mind on his last day. If you want to know what was on his mind, that's it. But not only was his destiny on his mind, but his disciples were also on his mind. Look at the second part of verse 1. He had loved his disciples during his ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. His last day, and his disciples are on his mind. The Bible says here he loved his disciples during his ministry. If you know anything about those disciples during the ministry of Jesus, they weren't very stellar, right? They were just downright knuckleheads at times. Blew it. Just goofy and immature so often. And yet the Bible says that Jesus loved them during all of that. He had loved his disciples during his ministry on earth. I don't know about you, but I take away great comfort from that. That if he could love them, he certainly can love me, because I'm my own knucklehead at times, and I know that you are as well. There were times that those guys just needed a good thumping all the way across Galilee. And yet the Bible says he loved them during all of that. Not only does it say that he loved them up to this point, it says, and now he loved them to the very end. And that's probably even more stunning because of what we know they're about to do. They're about to run away. They're about to deny him, to curse that they even would know him. They're about to run in fear, and his mind is made up. He's still going to love them anyway. He still loved them even when they ran, even when they betrayed him, even while he hung on the cross. He still loved them. His devotion to them was unshakable. And let me remind you today, if you're a child of God, his devotion to you today is also unshakable. You've deserved a thumping across Central Alabama. So have I. But he still loves us. He loves us. His faithfulness to us is far greater than all of our failures. That's what was on his mind on the last day. His destiny, his disciples, third thing on his mind, his defector. There was a defector among them. Look at the text, verse 2. It was time for supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. See, something unseen by human eyes was happening in the heart of Judas, something that none of us would be able to see was happening between Judas and Satan. They were conspiring together against Jesus. Outwardly, Judas looked like he was a follower of Jesus. But that was only outward. There was no interchange. He was counterfeit. You know, maybe today, up to this point in your life, you've lived outwardly like a follower of Jesus. But it's just not real. The heart hasn't really been changed. You haven't truly been born again. The good news for you, if that's you today, it's not too late. You're here. And you're hearing the word preached. And maybe even right now, you're sensing the Holy Spirit working in your heart to draw you to be changed on the inside, to be saved. Jesus was fully aware of every thought and every word that had been passed between Satan and Judas. That was on his mind. His destiny, his disciples, his defector. The fourth thing that was on his mind was his dominion. His dominion. Look at verse 3. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over, you see that next word? Everything. That word in the Greek means everything. The Father had given Jesus authority over everything. He knew that, and he knew that he had come from God, and he knew that he would return from God. Listen, if I'm a Jefferson County deputy, and God help our law enforcement officers in these days that we live in. I would not want to be one of them, and I am thankful for them. But if I were, let's say, a Jefferson County deputy today, I have no jurisdiction to patrol the streets in the city of Tuscaloosa. If I'm a law enforcement officer for the city of Tuscaloosa, I have no jurisdictions to patrol the roads of Jefferson County. It's not my jurisdiction. My jurisdiction has boundaries and borders, but Jesus' jurisdiction is limitless. No boundaries, no borders. His dominion has no limitations on it. You know why? Because the Bible just said his Father had given him all authority over everything. And as Jesus enters into this last day of his life before the cross, Jesus knows full well that he has all authority over everything. Every Roman soldier, every act of betrayal, every person that will be on that hillside that day, every molecule between us and the most far away galaxy, Jesus has all authority over that. And by the way, if I'm reading these words, this story for the very first time, I'm thinking to myself, I know what's about to happen. He knows what's in the heart of Judas, and he's got all authority. Brace yourself. He's about to rain down lightning bolts in this upper room, right? He's about to smite these suckers, especially Judas, because Jesus has all authority. He's about to flex. That's what I would be thinking if I'm reading this for the first time. He's about to flex all that authority on Judas, right? He's about to flex all that authority on Satan. He's about to flex all that authority on the religious leaders and on Rome, but that's not what he does. That's not what he does because of what's in his heart. So we've seen what's on his mind, but what's in his heart? What's in Jesus' heart is this: selfless love. That's what's in his heart. Instead of raining down lightning bolts, he picks up a towel. Verse 4 says he got up from the table. He took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. And then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that he had around him. What's he doing? He's God. He's King. He has all authority. By him and through him, all things have been made, and all things hold together. What is he doing? What he's doing is he's revealing what's in his heart. Love is what's in his heart. And I want you to see the story within the story here. Don't miss this. He got up from the table, the Bible says, reminding us of how he got up from his throne in glory, laid aside his position of prominence at that table, laid aside his position of prominence there in heaven, took off his robe as he did in heaven when he took off his glory, set it aside, wrapped a towel around his waist in that upper room like he wrapped himself in human flesh to step into this world. And he pours water into a basin. Just like in a few hours, he's going to pour his blood out to wash us clean of sin. The other gospel writers tell us that just before this moment, there was this big argument that broke out among Jesus' disciples, because apparently somebody had overlooked the very important detail that we got to have a lowly servant in this room to wash our feet before we eat. That was usually be the least ranking servant that would have that job. But there is no such person in the room. And while his disciples argue back and forth, the Son of God gets up, takes off his robe, wraps a towel around his waist, pours water into a basin, starts scooting around the floor going foot to foot. And you can imagine the embarrassment and the shame and the shock that filled that room as Jesus just keeps scooting himself and the water and the basin from person to person, including Judas, by the way. It's a selfless love. It's a love that's not only selfless, but it's a love that's a serving love. He said from the very beginning that he had not come to be served. He had come to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And even after 3.5 years, his disciples still haven't figured this out. They still haven't learned how to follow this example. They're too busy arguing about who among them is the best, who among them is the greatest. But the greatest one in the room is the one with the towel around his waist, washing feet without saying anything. This is love. And that's what's in the heart of Jesus. Selfless love. Serving love. But that's all pointing to a greater love, and that's a saving love. Look at verse 6. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus replied, "You don't understand now what I'm doing, but someday you will." "No," Peter protested, "you will never wash my feet." Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't belong to me." The disciples don't know what to say in this moment, but that's never stopped Peter, has it? Peter says, "We're not doing this, Jesus. You're not going to wash my feet." I can see Peter sitting crisscross applesauce on the floor with his robe tucked in down below his toes, sitting on top of that, just bowed up going, "This is not happening." He's probably realized now he missed the opportunity to follow the example that Jesus had set over the course of those 3.5 years, and now he's embarrassed, and now he feels out of place. He says, "Jesus, this is not going to happen." And Jesus says, "Peter, you don't get it now, but soon you're going to understand. I have to cleanse you for you to belong to me. If I don't wash you, you can't be mine." Listen, he's not talking about dirt and water anymore, is he? That's not what he's talking about now. Jesus is pointing us to the way people are made right with God. And he's saying to Peter, "Peter, you can't do this yourself. Nobody can make themselves right with God. We come to God just as we are." The point that Jesus is making is, "Peter, there's no other way for you to have a relationship with me, for me and you to be in fellowship, than for me to clean you, for me to wash you. You can't do that for yourself." Peter doesn't want Jesus to humble himself to a basin, but he does not know that in a few hours, Jesus is going to humble himself to a cross with not even so much as a towel to cover himself with. And Jesus will do that for Peter, to wash him clean. He'll do that for you and for me, to wash our sin away so that we can know him, to be in a relationship with him. Love is what's on Jesus' heart. This selfless, serving, saving love. It's also a sanctifying love. Sanctifying means it's a changing love. It's a cleansing love. It's a transforming love. Peter doesn't get it, right? He still thinks we're talking about dirt. We're still talking about water. So he tells Jesus, "Hey, Jesus, listen, all right then. If this is what it's going to take, then hose me down." Right? I can almost see Peter just standing in the basin, just going, "Just pour it all on me. Don't even worry about the rest of these chumps in the room. This is me, just head to toe, Jesus. Just bring it." Look at the text, verse 9. Simon Peter exclaimed, "Then wash my hands and my head as well, Lord, not just my feet." And Jesus replied, "A person who has bathed all over does not need to wash except for the feet to be entirely clean. And you disciples are clean, but not all of you." For Jesus knew who would betray him. That's what he meant when he said, not all of you are clean. See, we're not talking about dirt now. We're not talking about water now. 11 of the 12 didn't need a bath. They just needed some touch-up. They just needed their feet to be washed. That's good. Here's what he's telling Peter. Peter, you're already saved. You don't have to be saved again. By grace through faith, you've already been washed. You don't have to be washed again. Listen, if you're a child of God today and you've been saved, there's never going to be a day that you have to be saved again. Once he's washed you clean of your sin, you don't have to be washed clean of that sin again. But there will be, as God's people, times in our life that we'll need some touch up. Because as we walk through life, have you found this to be true? Even children of God still step in sin. Sometimes we step in it and we didn't mean to, but we do. And sometimes we mean to. And we don't just step in it. Sometimes we just camp out in it. And Jesus says, I don't have to wash you all over again, but I want to clean you. And he makes us this promise that if we'll confess our sin, he's what? He's faithful. And he's just to cleanse us of our sin from all unrighteousness. You don't need another bath. You don't need to be saved again, Peter. You just need forgiveness. Ongoing as God's people until we're face to face with him, we will need that forgiveness. That's what's on Jesus' heart. It's love. It's selfless love and serving love and saving love and sanctifying love. So we've seen what's on his mind. We've seen what's on his heart. Last, what's on his agenda? It's his last day. You know he's got an agenda. You would have an agenda. What's on his agenda? Look at the text, verse 12. After washing their feet, he put on his robe again. And he sat down and he asked, do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, because that's what I am. And since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you. There's his agenda. On his last day, the agenda of Jesus was to set an example. To show us how to live every day. Not just the last day. That's his agenda. Even when the world is about to come crashing in on you, keep serving. Even when those closest to you abandon you, keep serving. Even when somebody turns their back and betrays you, just keep serving. He says in verse 16, I tell you the truth, slaves are not greater than their master, nor is the messenger more important than the one who sends the message. Now that you know these things, God will bless you. He'll bless you for doing them. Jesus has this agenda to set an example so they will know how to walk in the blessing of God. He says, God will bless you if you'll do this. Listen, everybody in that room wanted to be great. Everybody in this room wants to be great. And this may shock you to hear this, but the desire to be great is not a sin. Do you know why we have that in us all, that we want greatness? Jesus put that in us. He created each of us with a desire to be great. Where the desire for greatness goes off the rails is when we want greatness as the world defines greatness and not the way God defines greatness. That's where it all goes wrong. We are created to desire greatness, but sin has bent us to desire the wrong kind of greatness. Not the kind of greatness that God created us to desire to have. He wants us all to be great, and he says, this is how you become great in my kingdom. You do for each other what I just did for you. That's what greatness looks like in the kingdom of God. The greatest king did that. And he says, if you're going to follow me and you're going to follow me in the path of greatness, then you do what I just did. You walk away from your positions of prominence. You take off your robes of recognition and you humble yourself and serve. Serve other people. Yes, your Judases are going to betray you. Serve them anyway. Your Simon Peters are going to deny you. Serve them anyway. Your Thomases are going to doubt you. Serve them anyway. You need some motivation to do that? Because that's pretty hard to do, isn't it? You need some motivation? He figured you would. That's why he gave us verse 17. Now that you know these things, God will bless you for doing them. How do you release those blessings from heaven? He just told you. You love with a love that's selfless. You love others with a love that's a serving love. You love other people with a sacrificing love, without any thought for personal gain, personal fulfillment, personal satisfaction. And God will bless your life. What kind of blessing are we talking about here, Pastor? The kind of blessing that the world can't offer. We're not talking about dollar amounts or automobiles or anything that the world would measure as a blessing. We're talking about something far greater than that. When you and I live every day like Jesus lived his last day, we're going to be blessed by heaven. And the blessing that we're going to receive when you and I live every day like Jesus lived his last day is this: the gospel will be seen in us and Jesus will be glorified through us. And that's the greatest blessing that a human being on planet Earth could ever know. To be a walking, breathing, living illustration of the love of God. A walking, breathing, living sermon of the gospel, of the kind of love that God has loved us with. When we live every day like that, God gets the glory and we get the joy. That is the greatest blessing, far and away, that heaven could ever pour out on us. So, let's live today and tomorrow and every day like it's his last day. Let's live it the way he did. Let's be about towels and not about titles. Let's be about people and not about prominence. Let's be about giving instead of taking. Let's live this day and every day like Jesus lived the last day. God, help us to do that. There's a restlessness in a lot of our souls because we want to be great by the standard of the world. We're fighting and clawing to one-up somebody else, to have more, to attain more, to do more, to achieve more and somebody else. And all the while, Jesus, you've set the example of what true greatness in the kingdom of heaven looks like, what true greatness in your eyes looks like. It's a towel. And a basin and water and a floor and dirt and grime and awkwardness. It's stepping into that like you stepped into it, Jesus. That's where true greatness lies. And Jesus, we want to know you more. That's been our heart's desire over these weeks. So today we want to listen and hear you scooting across the floor as you serve. We want to hear the sound of dripping water off nasty feet into a basin. We want to see your hands scrubbing dirt and grime and making clean. It's in these things, God, that we come to know you better. We want to behold it, and we want to become that. We want to behold that kind of love, and we want to demonstrate that kind of love. We want to behold that kind of service, and we want to live that kind of service. God, help us to do that. Help your church, the body of Christ, to do what the body of Christ has done. So that you, Jesus, and your gospel and your love would be seen in us and through us for your glory and for our joy. In Jesus' name. I want to invite you to stand and let's worship the Lord. Listen to the Holy Spirit as He speaks to your heart. What doesn't look like Jesus in your life? Hand that over to Him today. Would you find your place on the floor? Would you find your towel? Would you find your place of need and start serving?
And now we paid our ransom. His
world to see who he is through us, through his people, through the body of Christ. Amen. As we come to know him better, who he is works its way in us and through us, and he gets the glory and we get the joy. Amen. Amen. Hey, I've debated whether or not to share this with you guys today, and thought I wouldn't, but I think I will. It's really, really time for us to get out of here. All these Sundays, I stand here and I never say a word about moving. Never. I've not brought that to our windshield on Sunday mornings. We want to keep Jesus on the windshield all the time, but especially when we're gathered together on Sunday morning. I just want you to know, man, I am really just ready, and we're ready, and we're really close. And I am specifically praying that our Good Friday service will be the first service that we have at the new place. Now, that's up to the Lord, and his ways are perfect. That's all we want, are his ways. But let me tell you why I'm really praying for that. I've launched some sermon series over the last 18 months thinking, okay, Lord, this will be the one that carries us over to the new place. I'm out of sermon series. That's the truth. I finished up that little series last week, and I got home that evening. I told Shannon, I said, I'm done. I got nothing left. She said, you've preached the whole Bible? I said, pretty close. Pretty close. I don't know where to go from here. Monday, I came in. I don't know. I don't know what we're going to do today. Pray and read and pray and read. Come on, Lord. And then he thumped me like, you know, I kept expecting him to do those disciples. He thumped me. Probably took a couple of times. He thumped me. And I'm not sure that he said this, but this is the way it felt in my heart. He went, you idiot. Maybe he doesn't call you an idiot, but sometimes I need that. And he said, preach about me. This is not a time to preach Nehemiah building something or Joshua taking people across the Jordan. All those kind of messages that would kind of come in mind, that, oh, this would be like appropriate for what, you know, we're about to move. So God said, preach about Jesus. And so that's what we're doing from now to Easter. And that's what we do every week, I think, I hope, I pray anyway. But we just want to bear down and look at this final week of Jesus. But man, I really would just be thrilled to know that the first time we gather in that new place, you won't see me. You won't hear from me. Most of the time, nobody knows I'm at the Good Friday service. I would love for our first time that we get to that place to be about Jesus and what he did at the cross. Not about a building, not about moving, not about all the wonderful men and women that have sacrificed so much to get us there. That it's the cross, it's Jesus. That Sunday it'll be Easter. Somewhere after that, we'll thank the Lord for the provisions and the blessings and the people and all that, right? But Jesus first. Amen? Now, so that's up to God if he will orchestrate it that way. But I want you to know, and I was struggling whether to tell you that or not, but I felt like my heart ain't synced up with y'all's heart today, because what my heart's heavy for, I haven't even told you, but now I've told you. My heart is heavy that we have Good Friday service at that new place, and I'm just telling the Lord, that's what my heart's heavy for. I want us to worship the Lord that night and focus on Jesus and what he did at the cross that night. So would you just join me in praying that that'll happen? If it doesn't, we're going to praise him. If it does, we're going to praise him. But I can't think of a better night and a better way to step into that place than that way. Amen? Amen. All right. That's off my chest. I love you. Get to praying, people. Get to serving the Lord. I'll see you soon.